Good morning and welcome to the 19th meeting of the Constitution, Europe, External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2024. Our first agenda item is to begin to take evidence as part of our pre-budget scrutiny on funding for culture. And I'm delighted we're joined this morning by Lucy Cassett, Chief Executive of Museum and Galleries Scotland, Susan Deegan, Chief Executive of Glasgow Life, Leonie Bell, Director of the V&A in Dundee, and Anne Lydon, Director General of the National Galleries of Scotland. A warm welcome to you all this morning. If I could begin with a question before we move to questions from members. In last year's pre-budget scrutiny report from the committee, we said that there was an urgent need for the Scottish Government to restore confidence in the culture sector. And I just wondered, in your view, is that progressing? And I'll maybe start with, well, does anyone want to jump in on that one first? Maybe start with you, Lucy, then, if that, sorry to put you in the spot.
thank you, Convener, and thank you for the invitation to join the committee today to talk about the issues facing the museums and galleries sector. It's been a really, having read through the evidence, you can see it's a really sobering set of evidence that sets out those challenges that there are, and I think that urgency has only got more intense, I think, over the past year. The issues facing our museums and gallery sector is part of that wider context across the culture sector, and we absolutely acknowledge the issues that are, and they are, facing right across the whole of our culture sector, and it's a very interconnected sector. So the issues facing one part will absolutely affect others. So Museums and Galleries Scotland, we're the national development body for 452 museums and galleries across Scotland. And I think while we're talking about those needs today, it's important also just to recognise what an incredible asset they are to Scotland. They're distributed right across our country and our communities, and delivering a huge range of different benefits. And we should consider them to be assets. And they are assets that are at risk. So our survey that we've just conducted that closed in August across the museum sector suggests that 108 responses that we had to that survey, 11% of our museums and gallery organisations consider themselves to be at risk of closure within the next 12 months. And that's quite a frightening figure. It's certainly the worst I've seen it in 25 years working in the sector. So I think those pressures are really, really intensifying. I think we also need to recognise that those who are not at risk of closure are also not thriving in any sort of sense of that. There have been hollowing out of services across the piece in terms of particularly skills that are being lost from the sector. The pressures to keep the doors open mean that some of the things that we're losing, and is that what's at risk here, is the programming, the benefits that museums and galleries bring to communities, the programming that they do, the care that they provide for the collections, the ability to refresh museums, refresh exhibitions, to bring visitors in, to connect with communities. These things are being lost right across the piece. So it is a really difficult position that we find ourselves in. And I would say, yes, it has got worse in the last 12 months rather than better. So it's great to have the opportunity to discuss that today.
Thank you. Susan?
Thank you very much. And thank you again for inviting me to come along today. I suppose I would like to maybe talk about the kind of the beyond the perfect storm that I think was referred to last year, because in terms of the contribution that Glasgow Life makes to the city of Glasgow from a cultural perspective, that's across museums and galleries, across culture, across libraries, which we have to remember are a significant part of the cultural infrastructure in our country, and majority, if not all, of our funding for Glasgow Life comes from local government. And so the squeeze on local government and the continued reduction in local government funding means that local authorities are making difficult choices about teachers, care, homelessness services, other budget pressures, and therefore there's a real vulnerability around the local authority funding for culture. I know that CLUK and Creative Scotland have done some work on that. I've not seen the report. I'd be interested to kind of look again at what that's saying. But I understand in the evidence that SITFA, Solace and COSLA have already provided to the committee. They have identified a 20% reduction in local authority funding for culture and leisure from 2010, 2011 to 2022-23, and their submission expresses significant concerns about the sustainability of the culture and leisure sector. And in addition, I understand that Sillips, in a recent letter to local authorities, has estimated that there's been a 30% reduction in funding for libraries since 2010. Like Lucy, I'm keen to take an asset-based approach and the cultural assets, the wide-ranging cultural assets, but a national, but again, important to not lose sight of local culture and local cultural assets and how much that contributes to our cities and our communities across the country. And drawing attention to the real risk from reduction in local authority funding to cultural provision across Scotland.
Thank you. Fiona?
Good morning. Thanks for having me here today. I guess to try and see the question about confidence from the cultural sector towards the Scottish Government, I suppose I'd like to turn it around. I think we'd all really feel the benefit of the Scottish Government's confidence in the cultural sector and the sort of behaviours and strategies and approaches that would enable that. I think everybody recognises Perfect Storm, all the external factors that have created volatility and precarity across all areas of society, but the cultural sector perhaps feeling it very, very keenly, and then everything, of course, that's happened in more recent weeks and months. The question's deeper because actually the sector doesn't feel confident. So for the sector to feel confident, it's from that position that it can be the opportunity for Scotland. And at the moment, I think there's a sense that we're seen as a series of problems to solve and a series of risks to mitigate against becoming even greater risks. And none of us want to be like that. None of us are running our organisations like that. And none of those individuals that form part of that vital freelance community are problems. They're all some of the most dynamic and creative and skilled and talented assets we've got as a country. So I think for us to flip from the problem to the opportunity requires us to understand what Scottish Government, and actually I don't think this is just for the Scottish Government. I think there are major funders and stakeholders in culture, which our local government is Creative Scotland, is of course the Scottish Government, and their overview that becomes connected links funding to strategy that gives us a sense of what that amalgamation of state wants from culture, actually, and then following through with those tactics and decisions and priorities and, you know, release of funding that's, you know, appropriate to kind of scale of delivery and impact. I think it would give the sector its confidence back, and I think that's probably what we all want to see happen, and I think we're all here to try and find ways to get to that point.
And thank you.
I don't need to press anything.
No, you don't. No, the microphones should come on automatically.
Thank you. Thank you, convener, and thank you to the Culture Committee for allowing us the opportunity to come here this morning and have a very museum and galleries focused conversation. It is very much appreciated. And just echoing what my colleagues here have sort of shared with you this morning, there is still a great deal of precarity in the sector. And that does not breed confidence looking forward into the future. And that is exactly what we're all charged with, is trying to future-proof our organisations and ensure that the art and culture is available for the people of Scotland in perpetuity. And of course, that is a major foundation element of the National Galleries of Scotland. We are finding that we still, with this uncertainty in which we're sort of operating in, things are just continuing to back up, whether that's estate backlogs, where our ageing infrastructure, and again, we won't be alone in this. This will be the case for many institutions up and down the country. There needs to be proper investment in that, and that links to the capital budget, and again, how the uncertainty around capital and its allocation is proving a real challenge for any sort of projects going forward. Even when those projects are proven to be solutions in terms of best value, in terms of carbon reduction, in terms of, again, just greater accessibility. And with that, I'm talking about our artworks project in Granton, in North Edinburgh. We know that we can secure external funding from that, but we cannot do that without first receiving anchor funding from government. And that, in a way, is a situation that we find right across the sector. There needs to be a confidence and a commitment in funding what it is that we offer, this asset that we've all spoken about. And with that, we know we can then unlock other investment, other support. but it has to come first from the government in order to give it that that validation and signal to the people of Scotland that this does matter. Our public offer is not funded through our grant in aid. As noted in our submission, 93% of our grant in aid goes towards salary cost, and the remaining 7% is going towards our buildings. And again, that's still not enough for our operations and the backlog that we have. So everything that we do, and we do a tremendous amount, both locally, nationally and internationally, is all through self-generated income and support from external funders. That isn't sustainable for the future. So we are really keen on looking at what we can do to help this entire ecosystem. Because again, part of our national remit is being able to share the collection with the people of Scotland. I spoke about this, I think, in the January Culture Committee meeting, where for us to share that collection, we rely on our partners around the country to be able to take the collection, to share it with their local audiences. We can't do that if they're in, as 11% are threatening to close. So it is very much, we're all interconnected, and this is something that we are facing, and I think we're all pretty much united on what our asks are for the government.
Okay, I'm going to move to questions from the committee. Megan is joining us online, as you can see. And I'm going to begin and invite Mr. Bibby first.
Thank you, convener. I wanted to ask you about the announcement by the Scottish Government last week of, in the programme for government, about a review into Creative Scotland. And obviously that has potential impacts on budgets and the way culture is funded going forward. Have you any thoughts on what that review should include in terms of whether that should be how that should be run, whether that should be independent of government as opposed to a government review? Do you think it should look at more than just Creative Scotland as an organisation? Should we be looking at how we support the creative industries and the culture sector more generally than just through Creative Scotland? I wondered if you had any thoughts on that review and how that can impact on funding and also how we support the sector more generally.
Want to direct your question, Neil, or
I think V&A received Creative Scotland funding, is that correct?
I'm very happy to take the question. Yeah. V&A Dundee is directly supported by the Scottish Government.
Scottish Government.
We did in our capital project that built V&A Dundee receive capital support via Creative Scotland. So I can't speak as an individual or somebody that's an applicant for multi-year funding, but I think we probably all feel we can speak as part of that sector I think the first thing maybe to say about the review is that nobody wants it to distract from the very real urgency around the fact that there's organisations and individuals across the sector who have no knowledge of whether they'll be funded from next spring or sooner. So I think it has to happen alongside the carrying on of what we hope is really good public service in terms of administrating funds to keep people running viable, thriving businesses and keeping people in employment, as well as all the other benefits that we're aware of. So I guess that's the first point. The second point, I think, is back to maybe comments that we've all made and that we all maybe represent just by being here looking at Museums and Galleries Scotland today, is that Creative Scotland plays a really unique role, but I think probably that unique role does need to be looked at and re-articulated. It's got a really, I think people look at the screen model as being successful. I think it is time for the arts to have its day alongside the support Creative Scotland gives to screen and policy work around creative industries. So I think we welcome that. I think one of the impacts and the kind of the disturbances that we're seeing within the funding environment at the moment, if that's a good way to describe it, is that we all benefit if Creative Scotland is in a strong position. The country benefits, the sector benefits, but to do that, we all benefit when that partnership across Scottish Government, Creative Scotland, and the other major funder, local government, work together in strategic partnership to set out what the state view of that investment is. And I think other colleagues have kind of mentioned this as well, that the injection of public funding, no matter the source that it comes from, isn't investment like any other. It is the multiplier, it is the unlocker. It is the validation that you're doing something that your country or your place believes as part of what that country wants to be, what it says to its own people and what it says to the wider world. So to have a highly functioning Creative Scotland is in everybody's interest. I think, I just hope that the review has a momentum that doesn't distract, as I was saying, but that also can have an expanded view. It first of all has to really, I think, reconcile what Creative Scotland's unique purpose is and to work out what level of resource it needs to be able to perform its public service duties around funding and the other roles that it has. But we can't look at the stability and the sustainability and what we all want as a thriving cultural sector without having an expanded view beyond Creative Scotland and to deeply understand how Creative Scotland interacts with other strategies and policies. There's no, I don't know, I mean, maybe sport could argue very well, but there's not really many other areas of society other than culture and probably sport and leisure would fall into this, that interacts so easily with every other area of government interest. You look at all the priorities and programme for government, culture is within all of them. It's in all of those priorities. So that review has to have an expanded view, but then really hone in on what Creative Scotland's remit and function is, if that is an answer.
Yeah, any other thoughts? Yeah.
Happy. I suppose maybe it's a different question. The Scottish Government has produced a cultural strategy and it's produced a cultural strategy action plan. So is the review also then about where does the leadership sit for the delivery of that action plan? So Creative Scotland is part of that. But so are many other organisations. So I think maybe in terms of our submission, that was one of the questions that we asked. How does a national strategy and how does then funding flow from that national strategy through an action plan? And I suppose my contribution would be it would be helpful for the wider cultural sector to understand how you deliver the ambition set out in the national cultural strategy, the actions identified in the action plan, and how the funding flows through that to deliver the outcomes that are set out. So that would be my suggestion as well.
Thank you. Yes, I think it's important to recognise that the museums and galleries are funded differently to the rest of other parts of the culture sector. So it's not part of the remit of Creative Scotland. I know we as the National Development Body support museums and galleries, but in a different way. There are a small number of museums and galleries that can access Creative Scotland funding because they also do contemporary work. But for the most part, they're funded differently. And one of those key differences is there is no core funding for the museums and galleries sector. And that's a really core difference, that there isn't that ability to apply for regular funding for that three-year security. Museums and galleries are either funded through local government, about a third of the sector, about 30% of the sector are civic museums. Mm. But the great majority of them are independent charities that are trying to fund themselves through income generated through activity, and that's become increasingly difficult. And there is no, if trying to go from project funding to project funding model at the moment, that the core that is there to support those projects, and the projects want new staff and they want new activity, core functions within museums are really, really at risk. And there are a number of museums particularly. So I think the two areas that are most at risk are civic museums and the large independent museums that are charities that don't have any sort of anything to fall back on. So I think we need a review. We need to think strategically about how we invest in museums and galleries. I think museums and galleries have slightly distinct issues, but they're part of that wider conversation as well. So I think how we look strategically at those different pieces needs to be considered together, but also in terms of the distinct issues that different parts of our culture sector face. Thanks.
Yes, thanks. Just to sort of echo what colleagues here have said, that we, while we're very separate and we receive no funding from Creative Scotland, we of course are part of that sort of support system and ecosystem that we've talked about so much. And we rely on artists. Our entire collection is the creative outputs of artists over the years. And so Creative Scotland is very important in being able to support that part of the equation for us. But there is definitely clarification needed around the funding models. And as Lucy said, we don't receive that direct funding from Creative Scotland, whereas down in England, you've got the Arts Council and they are funding right across the sort of museum gallery portfolio to different degrees, obviously, but it's still there. So that does create confusion within Scotland as to who is funded and from where and how it all works. So I think that there is an opportunity with the review to clarify that and to be clear in the communication as to what the systems are, and also then to be able to, whether or not that then sort of stretches to support in other areas of museums and galleries coming from Creative Scotland, but to be then able to amplify and talk about what that funding model is for the rest of the sector. Creative Scotland is vitally important to culture here in the country. But oftentimes you would think that it's the only source of culture in the country, and of course that isn't the case. And again, just to reiterate, I think that's what we appreciate for this morning, being able to have the time to represent our sector in a way that perhaps hasn't been offered before.
You got supplementary?
Yeah, on it. I just wanted to ask about specifically about Glasgow, in the sense that we've got fantastic cultural assets in Scotland. It was fantastic to visit V&E in Dundee over the summer, and we've got many great museums and galleries in, across the country. In terms of that, we're talking about the squeeze on cultural funding nationally, which will affect everybody. It's affecting everybody, that's clear. We've also got the squeeze on local authority budgets. I just wondered if there's a particular... Everyone's feeling the squeeze on that. I just wondered if Glasgow in particular, with Kelvin Grove Museum and other assets, which are in many ways national assets but not regarded as national assets, whether Glasgow... Notwithstanding, everybody is struggling at the moment, whether Glasgow was particularly struggling alongside, other local authorities will be, but extra additional pressures in Glasgow because of that double whammy, potential double whammy.
Happy to answer that question. Thank you very much. I suppose just to start off, there is no direct national funding for Glasgow Life's museums at all. All of the funding comes from local authority, as Glasgow City Council, despite being a major contributor to the city, and I would suggest Scotland's economy. And I think the contribution to the national organisations, whether it's V&E, the National Galleries, the National Museums, National Libraries, all of those organisations is well documented. But what I would maybe like to draw the attention to is the contribution that Glasgow makes in terms of 135 million GVA, or nearly 4 million visits in 2022-23. We are back at pre-COVID visitor levels. We have an innovative approach to how we talk about the collections. We are a world leader in looking at the issues of repatriation. We have been innovative in looking at how we address issues of legacy of slavery and empire within our museums. So what you're getting with Glasgow is a real innovation. However, we have our real challenges, and I think the committee will probably be well aware that we did have industrial action last year, and that was absolutely as a result of looking to reduce our budgets. Glasgow Life's overall budget has been reduced by £17 million over the past 5 years, and over the past 10 years by £30 million. Now, that is a fact. We try our best to mitigate that through income generation, and the overall model that Glasgow Life presents does allow us sometimes to raise income from one part of the organisation that can offset across the wider organisation, but that can only go so far. So, yes, we are very vulnerable. I think, as all local authority services are, our libraries are equally as vulnerable because all of the funding comes from the local authority. And to echo Anne's point, and the rest of the UK Arts Council England would fund museums, the status, and I would suggest that Riverside Museums is Scotland's national transport museum, but we do not receive any national funding. All of Glasgow's collections are recognised as having national significance. So we are national in all but the funding arrangements.
Thanks,
Hazard. Thank you. Bring Mr. Harvey in.
Thanks very much. Good morning, everyone. I will come on to some of those longer-term issues that have already been raised in the discussion so far, but just to focus on the coming financial year for a moment, because we're looking forward to seeing a budget being produced by the Scottish Government for 25-26, and that's in the context of the commitment to increase funding so that it is at least £100 million more a year by 28-29. Now, obviously, we don't want to have to wait until 28-29 for that extra funding to come along, but we wouldn't expect £100 million a year all to come right at the start of that. What should we be looking for when we see the budget as a credible step in that direction, either in terms of consistency of funding or scale of funding? Because you've all mentioned the precarity, you've all mentioned the different sources of funding. The Scottish Government's funding is only one stream, your own income generation, other institutions, local government, as Susan was saying very clearly. But in terms of this commitment, what is a credible path toward that 100 million commitment by 28-29? What should we be looking for when we see the budget?
Anne, do you want to go first?
Okay. I think it's you have to consider how we can step away from this sort of firefighting, mm-hmm. and to create some space within the sector to allow for these plans to develop and to come to fruition. And in a way, that is a sort of invest to save, because you are trying to ingest money where it is needed that will ultimately support the sustainability and the thriving of the sector going forward. So I think it will be, you know, down to the committee to advise and for the ministers and the cabinet secretary to sort of determine the sort of the priorities for funding. We all have very viable projects, initiatives and capital plans that can help achieve all of the priorities, whether that's looking towards carbon net zero, mm-hmm. whether it's the health and well-being economy. But it just needs a bit more. We cannot be just clinging on to enough to keep us going. It's back to this. We need to be thriving and not surviving. So to be able to allocate according to where you can see those moments for kick-starting the thriving is basically where I would advise.
Anyone else?
Lucy? Yeah, thanks.
Yeah, so clearly no easy answers to that question. I absolutely agree with Annie. The more that we can invest in, we have a national strategy for culture, we have a national strategy for museums and galleries, and to try to back up those strategies and those organisations that are able, how we can take those objectives forward. But that might require some look across it, strategically across the piece at what's being delivered, where those assets are, where that skill still is. We know there's real precarity around some areas of expertise, for example. So looking at who still has these potential for taking the sector forward in a more strategic way that isn't just, plugging the gaps. Though there are some gaps that we were arguing for this 5 years ago, saying let's look strategically, mm-hmm. now. We can see this trajectory. We can see this change. We need to look now at how do we do that in such a way that we're managing that change, because the change is inevitable. And we can manage that change in a more innovative way if we look at it strategically. And sometimes that does require a bit of investment up front to look at how we do that, because it's not about resisting or trying to fill every or do everything the way we used to do it. There are ways we want to do things better and serve communities really well, in the communities we haven't previously had as much access to culture as before. And the sector is really ready to do that work. But while we're still cycling through these actual crisis to crisis, it's really hard to do that. So the more of that money that comes sooner enables that investment to, mm-hmm. to try and make sure that we're able to do that, because we have reached this point where there's so many organisations in crisis that they're struggling to do the really good work we know that can be done.
So you're looking, obviously there'll be an amount of money allocated in the coming budget, but you're also looking for a plan for the 5 years ahead, for this course of increased funding you want a sense of what the longer term plan is. Is
yeah,
right?
I think that would be incredibly valuable. And we totally appreciate that the number of requests that there are and the sums of money available are not going to be able to fulfil all that, mm-hmm. but just to make sure that the issues for museums and gallery sector are heard alongside mm-hmm. the rest of the issues facing the culture sector. But as they say, we've got a lot of shared plans and ideas of how to do this if we just had the resource to do it.
I think it has to be used to incentivise as well. So we have to move from what is a very competitive environment. I think the kind of the current phrase is it's a nil-sum game. Everybody is competing. Nobody is collaborating because everybody is trying to survive. So therefore, what is the incentive to collaborate? And what is the incentive, I think, as we use in the health context of moving upstream to actually understand what change and what does a sustainable cultural sector actually look like? Mm-hmm. And I think that's a really difficult question to ask the sector itself. But what has to be done is to create, I suppose, a stable platform to enable that discourse to take place and to understand that change needs to happen. So I think we have to use some of that money for change because actually, as Lucy said, just plugging the gaps means that what we will do is survive and we won't necessarily grow and thrive.
And if I could maybe just build on it, I mean, obviously the culture sector is very, very diverse. You all represent fairly substantial institutions and organisations within the kind of cultural landscape. Does the Scottish Government engage with you directly? Do you have access to the thinking within government about what this commitment of increased funding is going to look like? Because it seems to me there is a worry about whether it's going to end up being spent on culture activity or whether it's going to be spent on the other costs that culture organisations have. Somebody mentioned net zero, I think it might have been Anne a few minutes ago. You know, whatever proportion of that 100 million goes to museums and galleries could very easily be swallowed up by decarbonising your buildings. To what extent do you have a sense that the government is thinking about how this funding is additional to your culture activity rather than to other costs?
Can I answer your first question and then your second one, if that's okay? Not to repeat what colleagues have said, because I think we're all cohering around the same concept of the relationship of funding with strategic priorities that span the major stakeholders, and also recognise that the Scottish Government has a strategy with objectives, so do local government, and they vary to context of their place, and then organisations within the context of their place and whether their remit spans national to local, as mine does. This is the coming together of all of that. But I think it is also important to think about the agency we're giving to organisations and local government through the national funding as well, because we've got significant resources, agencies of government, public bodies that can carry a lot of work if funded well. The other thing is multi-year, is having a shot at knowing that what we've all experienced in the last few years is turbulence in year, not knowing if you'll see through the year with your current funding makeup is obviously a disturbance for any business or organisation. The cultural sector feels that sharply and keenly, and there's immediate effect. But to have a sense, and there was a time when it felt, still I think should be a really reasonable one, that we don't lose sight of the 1% as well as the political and policy commitment that's gone to getting to the 100 million. I think 1% for culture is something I think many of us would still like to see being discussed, and how do we all work to get to that? So 1% of the Scottish Government budget going to the widest, to the culture sector in its broadest terms. So it's about the funding and how it's profiled. So I think in the shortest term, to answer your question directly, is I think clarity in December that it's coming, when it's coming, what its profile, as much as anybody can give mm-hmm. over a number of years, but also that commitment the Scottish Government have also made to trying to get to the whole sector to a sense of being able to plan 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 years in advance, because that's how V&A Dundee works. We've got international markets. We're planning major shows that can take 3 to 5 years to develop due to their scale and complexity, but you get the impact from yeah. that. But it's through that we're more efficient with that funding. We are all public servants. We want to do right by the public money we get. To do the best by it, we need to have the longest view of how regular it will be, and I think that's probably true of all organisations. In terms of where the money goes, I guess I would maybe try and counter it gently, if I may, in that without the estate, without the cultural estate, we don't have the places that many people recognise as being both traditional Scotland, innovative Scotland and contemporary Scotland. So the places where we go and where we work, the places where people go to convene and gather to have cultural experiences, whether that's an organisation like mine or a national institution or a small civic museum or a festival on an island or a major festival, they all have an infrastructure around them that requires investment to be able to keep up to date. And obviously everybody wants to address the climate change. So the cultural, I think it's a really interesting question that we have to pay our workers. We have to pay to maintain our estates, which in themselves are cultural assets. I mean, speaking on behalf of V&A Dundee, obviously we've quickly become an icon and a symbol, not just of Dundee, but of contemporary Scotland. But maintaining that building requires investment. But I think that investment has significant impact. Mm-hmm. So I wouldn't look to see a separation of activity from what the workforce and the estate and its infrastructure requires. I think what we need is an understanding of the interaction between all of the funding, private, philanthropic and public, and that through long-term investment with that understanding of how we're cohering strategic objectives together means we do the best by that money. Mm-hmm. And at the moment, there's too many disturbances occurring. And I think we all want that just a little bit of calm for a wee while.
Thank you.
I think too, it's...
Sorry, that's fine. And you go first, I'll bring Lucy in a second.
So sorry.
No, it's fine. And you go first.
What I'm going to say is actually quite right now. I think we're all collaborative, albeit we're speaking at the same time. I think where I would be looking for government to think about this challenge of they could easily spend 100 million five times over because of the asks that are out there.
Yeah.
So I think it really does have to be strategic in thinking about, well, where is that collaboration happening? And there's evidence of that right across the board, where then you are going to have that impact, not just with one single institution or one organisation, but that it has a benefit to a wider community or it has a benefit to the sector. And I think that there's... that would be what I would be expecting, a review of what those sort of projects are and where those sort of overlaps and interactions take place, because we are all in agreement and we are all working towards the same national outcomes. So it's the idea of somehow we're sort of waiting for the crumbs at the table is just, that's not going to sustain us going forward. It has to be much more collaborative. There is, of course, the public sector reform that's taken place, and there's various clusters around that, and there is a culture cluster. And National Galleries of Scotland participate in that alongside the other two national collecting bodies, the library and the museums, also the National Records and Creative Scotland. But we have been talking about the need to sort of open that up and include more voices from the sector, because we can't do this alone. And also to open up beyond the culture sector, because a lot of what we do is in health and well-being, yeah. It's in all areas of Scottish life. So there has to be an awareness that we are not just working in isolation, and this isn't just a matter of black holes that need to be filled with resource. We are servicing the entire country through various programs, initiatives, through our buildings, as Leonie said. They become part of our very fabric of what it means to be Scottish. So to fund with that mentality in mind, with that sort of outset as to what a future Scotland would look like if indeed we had at least 1% funding for culture, that's where I would want to see this discussion going. Okay. And thinking about it in that way.
Lucy.
I just really wanted to add to everything I agree with my colleagues on, but just that there's this really broad agreement that culture delivers right across a number of portfolios. And for most portfolios in government, culture has a connection with. And so when we talk about the funding for culture, the ability to unlock
the benefits that the culture sector is providing across other portfolios is something that, is an aspiration that, we have as a sector that we share with Scottish Government. But we as organisations cannot unlock that ourselves, and that's where we kind of that partnership with Scottish Government to be able to see whether we can, you know, unlock some of the, potential there in that case for example, net zero funding. We need to bring that estate. If we're collectively going to reach net zero, then the museum buildings are, many of them are old listed buildings, many of them have had a lack of maintenance for many, many years. The opportunity to invest in that, that actually has the double benefit of reducing running costs as well as having those government benefits. And we have been doing that with some Scottish Government money in the last 2 years that we no longer have this year. It's not available this year because we've seen a cut in that funding. So the opportunities are there to do that, but we do need Scottish Government to help unlock that cross-portfolio opportunity. It's not something that we as organisations can really have access to do.
Mm-hmm. Yep. If I could just add one more point, and it is mostly for Susan rather than going round the table again, because you've spoken most about the local level, and I've got a question about broadening or diversifying the local sources of funding. We've seen Parliament legislate for the visitor levy, giving local authorities the power, and Edinburgh has been the first mover on that, but I hope it's not the last, looking at generating revenue which might be particularly relevant for parts of the culture sector that don't have core funding, for example. Some of the music venues at the moment are making the case to do something similar with a stadium levy. How much further could we go? Is there more opportunity to create not just a different way of using central government funding, but more powers at the local level to generate the revenue to put that to use according to local priorities?
To answer that question, but maybe if I could start, but then why should that just be local authorities? Because then what the burden then once again is on mm-hmm. local authorities to collect local taxation to fund what I would suggest as core mm-hmm. National assets in the case of Glasgow's museums. Sure. But notwithstanding,
I'm only really saying it because all local taxation is devolved and we don't have that constraint on national tax.
I totally understand that, and I think it's quite interesting. I've had a look at it, and obviously I think all local authorities, I mean, will be looking at it, and I think you will be aware that there's been recent motions that mm-hmm. At Glasgow City Council regarding the visitor levy. I would suggest that the ability for Edinburgh to generate income from that will be far greater than Glasgow due to the value of the, if it's a percentage levy, of their average room rate. And again, so Glasgow will have probably less funding at its disposal. Again, further skewing, I would suggest, the balance of funding between the Edinburgh and Glasgow, with the majority of the cultural institutions and Edinburgh funded by the Scottish Government. So the availability of funding through the visitor levy will be less in Glasgow, I anticipate, mm-hmm. and all the modelling would suggest that. Mm-hmm. But I think the important thing to remember about the visitor levy also has to be discussed and agreed with the sector, so the tourism visitor sector, and they have to have an input into how that money is dispersed. Looking at Edinburgh, some of it's going to housing, some of it's going to filling potholes and infrastructure, some of it will go to culture. So, of course, we would welcome anything that comes from that, but I don't think it is going to fill that big hole, that big gap that there is there. And I suppose the wider cultural sector in Glasgow does disburse grants. I'm not here to, I haven't got all of those details, to cultural organisations, but very much in how they deliver against the Glasgow City Council strategic plan. And I would keep coming back to that understanding of the value of culture. I was at the Culture Value Summit back in May and did present there about the role of culture and wider culture. But I don't see any output of that necessarily. You asked what engagement did we have with government. I would have hoped some of that evidence might have come forward as part of the pre-budget discussion as to what were some of the recommendations coming from that. And that would be maybe some new ideas and some radical thinking. So in that space, so I would welcome, and I always have wanted to participate in that space. But I think one of the challenges at a local level is really that understanding that culture isn't just nice, is seen as nice to have. rather than need to have. So if you're facing issues of teacher numbers, then actually you have a direct, I mean, it shouldn't be a binary issue, but it does become a binary issue as to do you fund teacher numbers or do you fund culture? And I think that's the stark reality of the space that local authority cultural funding sits at the moment.
Okay, thank you.
I'm just going to move to Alexander, but I want to ask, I sort of dig a little bit deeper about what you've all called as the ecosystem that you all work in, and you describe some of that as competition rather than, you know, working together in collaboration. But particularly, and it's probably for you, is decisions that are made by Creative Scotland and the culture funding nationally, what impact they have on the wider ecosystem when they happen. So thankfully it didn't happen, but had the iWrite Festival not happened, would that have been, is there a boost from the festivals to other cultural, do you get to see visitor numbers increasing at the times of festivals? Is there an ongoing impact for a decision like that that's maybe not fully appreciated at the time of decisions?
I can hope, yeah. And I think it's probably a wider. So in terms of the particular right funding, we were delighted to have a philanthropist come in and plug that gap. Mm-hmm. The really interesting bit iWrite is it does a number of things. It diversifies and the identity of authorship in terms of, you know, female representation and more diverse authors. But the real issue for us and the evidence, and I've got this somewhere, that coming along to an iWrite event means you're more likely to attend another cultural event. So I suppose it's that habit forming of actually attending cultural activity. So we see iWrite as a really important part of reader development. You know, I think everybody knows that reading is the most participated in cultural activity in Scotland, and actually young people reading at an early age is more evident, more supportive of their academic outcomes at school than their parents' socioeconomic background. So anything that can encourage people to love literature, to read, but also participate wider in cultural activity. So that's what we do. We do see. So yes, we were delighted that we were able to restage that event. But I do think that when you talk about the ecosystem, obviously, Glasgow has a wide range of festivals and events and cultural buildings, three receiving houses. So yes, I suppose that's what we see as the ecosystem. And we've recently in Glasgow launched a new culture strategy, which was developed with the sector. But part of the actions coming out of that is collaborative advocacy. And that is an opportunity to collaborate and creating that space to collaborate rather than compete about the power of culture, the role of culture, both in terms of health, in terms of education, economy and identity. And I think that's something all of us would agree, that the importance of culture and the identity of both our places, but also nationally. So that's how we are looking to try and bring Glasgow's ecosystem together, but it will be to advocate for the role of culture and the importance of Glasgow's culture to Scotland.
I'll go to Lucy first, then Leonie, thanks.
Thank you, and just thinking about that, how you expand that, you know, Glasgow, that local ecosystem into a national ecosystem. And I think, you know, Annie talked about the fact that for the nationals to be able to share their collections across the nation, you need museums and galleries across the Scotland to be in a position to work with those nationals, to be able to curate locally, to be able to respond to those collections. And the same applies to a lot of the much smaller museums that may not have any professional staff or professional curator, who have depended largely on local authority staff to provide some of that expertise and mentoring. And that, as well as in some cases grant funding, that's being really eroded as well. So that I think we need to value all of the museums and galleries of all different sizes, because there are places where, you know, the museum might not just, in terms of that sense of place, might be the only cafe on an island. It might also provide those other services as well as being the only cultural place. It might be the only indoor attraction for the tourists in that area on the rainy days we occasionally have in Scotland. We need to value the small museums as we value the large ones, because the interdependencies there that we have are absolutely critical. And it is actually a really kind of mutually supportive sector, and I think that, you know, the desire to do that and to work collaboratively is really strong, but collaboration and certainly partnership working takes capacity, because you've got to give and to others, and so that ability to really maximise what we know we can do is eroded. But I really think that whole ecosystem across the country, small to large, is really vital.
Okay. Leonie?
Thank you. I think maybe just if I can pick up on the competitive point, because I think I think Susan was meaning it in terms of the current environment that we're finding ourselves in, not that that's what we're striving to be. I think it's because there's frontiers being established that are exposing quite bumpy topographical sort of inequality across the sector, whether that goes from pay to access to pensions, all of those sorts of things. But actually, we all want to be able to work together with the assets that the different organisations have at their disposal. So I think everybody's setting out that there is all these interconnections. One bit goes down, other bits go down. So the iWrite example, of course, it's also festivals are also really good providers of fees and payment for artists as well. So you take that away, it stops another bit of work being created and all of those sorts of things. But I think my bigger point is twofold. One is that there are consequences beyond the difficulty of funding going, which are Scottish-wide, which are the accumulation of the disturbances that we're talking about and the current challenges that funders are experiencing and potentially their relationships is making those working in the sector, audiences, and probably those that at times have looked to Scotland as cultural leaders because we are seen as having an asset, a series of assets that are locally relevant, very much locally enriching and alive, but also speak to the rest of the world and bring the rest of the world to Scotland. So these bumps they have an impact on that. They have an impact on all of our reputations as well, is that direct funding. So it's the ecology, but it's also there's a wider, more maybe intangible consequence of it as well. And if I may just finish, convener, I've had the privilege to work in a number of the organisations that we're talking about. I've worked in the Scottish Government, I've worked in Creative Scotland, and I've worked for a shortish time in a local authority as well. And when you were in them, there's a tendency to see the world through the funding programmes that they have. But that actually isn't how any of us work. We work across those funding programmes and we work in a mutually symbiotic sort of like production to create the cultural life of Scotland. And some of it goes from a volunteer to the amateur community and sector right through to public bodies and agencies as well. So I think one of the tasks we have is to stop seeing and defining things through funding routes and actually look at the bigger picture and then look at what overall funding we need to keep that bigger thing going. And I hope that makes sense in response to your question.
Right, I'm going to move on to Mr. Stewart, who's been waiting very patiently.
That's okay. Answer. Thank you, convener. Thank you. You've all talked this morning about how the funding unlocks the potential within all of your organisations. And that funding is crucial to the success, to the sustainability and to the survival of your sector. And the £100 million that we know is coming down the line is really vital to making sure that that is sustainable for each and every one of you. But probably the biggest issue that you may have within your organisations is the staffing costs that you have to incur and about attracting people into your organisation. And if you are managing decline, which most of you have indicated you seem to be in that way of coping at present, how do you attract the next generation, the next leaders of your organisations to come to you to build on the success that you all have achieved so far with the limited resources and the budgetary constraints you've had to contend with, not just this year, but in years gone past? So the future is challenging, and you've said that. But it has to be the future of the people you invest in that makes the success for culture for the future. Now, if you're not able to backfill jobs and your current staff have to do more and you're not able to attract some of that potential, what should we as government and our organisations that are giving you that funding and are giving you that support, are there areas within that which you should see investing in staff, investing in personnel? Because I cannot see any way through any of the dilemmas you face unless we have that commitment to give you resource that can give you people, that can push your organisations and can inspire for the future. Because if you're not giving that opportunity and you don't have that opportunity, where do you go? What can you cut? What can you close? to maintain and sustain some part of your cultural activity. So it'd be good to get a flavour as to what you think of that, because I see that as one of the main obstacles or one of the main stepping stones for you all to thrive and survive, as Susan said earlier. Because if you can't attract the future people to lead your organisation will not survive. Thank you, Convener. Yeah.
Thank you. I very much welcome that question. It's something that we are very much trying to face into. The sort of situation is that within the sort of museum sector, museum gallery sector, we of course we have different cohorts of staff and colleagues, and it can be very difficult to attract into, say, the estates section of your organisation because of the competitive nature of the salaries that exist outside. There isn't the same sort of comparison available with curatorial colleagues, for example. We're just sort of comparing against other museums and galleries where it's, again, sort of endemic in terms of the in salary benefits and what we're sort of able to offer. So what we're sort of finding workload issues because we then cannot attract people into the kind of career of museums and galleries in vital service departments that are needed to keep our buildings going. We've had within the National Galleries numerous examples of positions being open and going for several months, almost into a year, to try and fill them with the right person just because we aren't competitive enough with the salary and the benefits that are offered. But the workload is a real challenge as well, because as we are then stretched, and I would say at the National Galleries of Scotland, we are very much stretched. We are at bare bones when it comes to our sort of staffing profile, and in terms of what we actually achieve with that is quite remarkable, but it's not sustainable for the long term. And so we've been doing a number of exercises internally where we are exploring this concept of how do you be a good ancestor? What decisions are we making now in 2024 that future generations will look back and thank us for? So we're encouraging colleagues to think about what would our institution look like in 2030, in 2050, and what changes do we need to do to get there? But there's various constraints, I mean, pay being one, but also we had two voluntary exit schemes within the last 5 years, and that's a blunt tool that means that we lose vital expertise, resource, and just numbers. And the impact of that can take years to recover from. And coupled then with the fact that we don't have the ability to draw people in to take up some of these roles, that then really creates a problem that will have ripple effect right the way out into the future. So it's an absolute challenge. And I think that one of the ways to look at that is how are we measuring success? What does success look like? And what does that workforce look like in order to then deliver those outcomes and sort of see where we are then again thriving rather than just surviving? But we can't do that alone. We can do the exercise internally. We can, you know, arrive at what our kind of desired future organisation will look like and what future generations will thank us for. But it always comes back to having then that anchor funding from the government, which again allows us to make these partnerships with others.
Thank you. Lucy?
Thank you. I absolutely welcome the question and thank you for the recognition of these really serious issues that we have and the implications that they have, as you say, for the future and our ability to work our way out of the situation we're in at the moment. I've got a real concern in the independent and small museums who even more so struggle to provide attractive salaries. There's a huge toll on staff well-being. And part of that comes from the uncertainty that people are working in. And I think if there was one thing that would really help with that is having that long-term ability, some sense of stability that allows people to
make the changes that need to be made or to be able to invest in the futures of organisations, because that constant being on the edge of a precipice, that precipice mm-hmm. fatigue is really real, and that staff wellbeing is a concern right throughout the level. So in terms of attracting people or encouraging people to stay and want to be in those more senior positions yep. and take on that load in a really precarious charity that every year is facing, that will we get through going concern, can we make a pay award? You know, these things are can we invest in pensions that are going to actually look at the future of our staff? These are really, really difficult questions. It's also questions, difficulty in finding people who want to be trustees and take on that responsibility for these organisations when they're in such a precarious situation. So any sense of stability or longer term possibility of looking on a slightly longer term allows that investment. But there is a lot of work going on in trying to invest in bringing new people into the sector and bringing different sorts of people into the sector and creating a more diverse workforce. Those programmes are there in terms of modern apprenticeships and different routes in that we're seeking to invest in, and those are really successful. But it's that, what's the future for it when you're trying to bring people in and sell, you know, the career to people we go into schools to kind of think of pre-subject choice about cultural careers. But you need to look in the news to hear how the challenges facing the culture sector, is it where I want to work, is definitely a kind of whole system issue. And I would just maybe say something about fair work as well, which is, you know, we are a low-wage sector. Fair work is something that the sector absolutely wants, recognises as the right thing to do. But there are some organisations who are now excluded from applying for any funding because they're unable to do that, or organisations where paying real living wage to the staff at the bottom, they're not able to make those progression payments to the next tiers up. And that, again, in terms of retention in the sector, is a real issue. And it's not for any resistance to that, because we all want to work in a sector where people are paid fairly for the work that they're doing. But it is creating some additional pressures. And I say some organisations who have not been able to do that are now also not able to apply for any funding. So just to pass that on from the sector.
Thank you, Lisa.
I'm happy to contribute. I mean, we have employed about just over 300 staff across 8 museums in Glasgow, so it's a substantial workforce. And we've been very lucky to hold on to some really, really experienced staff. And so our biggest challenge, but maybe opportunity, is succession planning and how do we grow our own, so to speak, and how do we invest in that internal learning and bring people up through the organisation. And I think, as Lucy mentioned, we have invested in diversifying our workforce and also modern apprentices. And there's a wee bit, I think, we put in our submission about fair work and modern apprentices, and making sure we don't lose that opportunity as modern apprentices, as a way to bring new people who would sometimes regard working in the sector as something that you only do if you've had a particular education or have a particular background. And so the role of modern apprentices in diversifying the workplace is really, really important. We shouldn't lose sight of it. But I would also maybe draw the committee's attention to an ECOS report that was published last year, November last year, that I think Museum Gallery Scotland and Vocal involved in. It talked about the impact of reduced funding in the civic museum sector and the erosion of a national skills base. Mm-hmm. And that one of the real challenges there was keeping the doors open. Mm-hmm. So I think the amazing assets that we all have, they are real anchor organisations. They're visual representations of our culture, of our cities, of our places. And nobody wants to close a museum. So what is happening behind the scenes is maybe a reduction in the workforce that sit behind the scenes, yep. Whether that's an education staff or whether that's in conservation staff, curatorial staff. And I think that's maybe the unseen bit at the moment that maybe people are not seeing because everybody's trying to keep the buildings open. What's the solution to that? I would like to think of myself as a solution-based person. And something Lucy talked about earlier is the role of local authorities maybe supporting the wider independent and voluntary sector museums. And so maybe there should be an investment in creating, you know, hubs of excellence. Yeah. You know, again, I think we referred to hubs in our submission. You know, so does Glasgow become a hub for the west of Scotland? And is that something that is invested in terms of supporting the skills and a range of skills that are essential to be that legacy for the future? So some reflections and a suggestion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Maybe from a Dundee and a V&A Dundee perspective, I've been lucky enough to be at a couple of cultural events in Dundee and Glasgow in evenings this week, and actually I was struck by the number of conversations I was having with, probably they won't mind me saying that I think they were under 35, but a number of them are leaving Dundee. Sometimes that's okay, they pursue other international or national opportunities that come up, but I think there's a growing sense that unless we think about a really dynamic range of opportunities, people within organisations and out with them, we are going to lose talent. We're going to lose talent across the generations. We're also not going to be able to, I think I can maybe speak for some of us on the panel here, that I come from a generation that was lucky to get a really good state education. I had significant opportunities and mentoring through organisations that receive public funding. I don't know if people from all backgrounds would have the same chances now. So I'd quite like to correlate and connect the answer to what we also do for and with audiences in our programme. So it's how we inspire and develop talent within our organisations and treat people as fairly and well as we can. But it's also how we reach out with what we do, because that everything that we do acts as role models and advocates in society through our buildings and our programmes, and we have to be really relevant. The world is changing at significant pace, and we must also keep our programmes, our access to collections, the retelling of collections very, very up to date. Otherwise, we will not attract people into the sector that actually will make our sector relevant to the future as well. And I see myself as a generation like in the kind of the crossroads of, you know, somebody that received significant benefit, but I can see the energy of new generations coming up, and we have to let them lead us now. Leadership exists across organisations. It's not necessarily hierarchical. We've got to kind of support that as it's coming. And I guess the other challenge that I think we're all having is, though we're employers, and we employed just over 100 people in Dundee, that's a significant thing in the city. That creative employment wasn't in the city to that degree before V&A Dundee opened, but we do that alongside many other organisations, and I think everybody else is talking about the sort of workforces we have in our teams are, yeah, they're creative and they're cultural, but they're also maintenance, they're IT, they're HR, they're finance. And I think all of us are probably experiencing quite significant strain on maintaining staff in the jobs where there's highly competitive market salaries across finance, HR and IT, especially where graduate salaries are commanding almost final salaries equivalent in the culture sector. So we're all, you know, working. For us to keep up to date, we also have to find ways, I think, to find like really exciting opportunities for people of all different backgrounds, degree, educate and otherwise, to kind of work in our organisation. One of those routes is through pay, but one of those is also because it's really great to work in the culture sector, because we hope we represent really progressive and you know creative values. I think the only other thing I would say is it's back to creative education, and this maybe this the state and the ambitions for that too from nursery on. But the creatively educated don't just thrive in creative organisations. The creatively educated, where we support curiosity, creative skills, the imagination from the earliest years where it's inherent within us, but we seem to educate it out. The creatively educated thrive in any organisation, and I kind of think that broader point is also something the committee might be interested in thinking about.
Good. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mr. Adam.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I agree with the importance of culture in society, full stop, and the fact that many of the Scottish Government's ambitions, you actually tick the boxes for what they're doing. And the iconic institutions that you represent, I respect that as well. But Susan, like you, I like to see I'm a solutions-based person as well. And one of the things when Patrick asked you a question earlier on, and I'm following all of you, he asked you a question, I'm just following on in that, mainly because probably we're the last two guys that were just recently in government were asking this question. But what kind of engagement, what is the mechanism for engagement with the Scottish Government and the Cabinet Secretary to say the things that you've said to us here today? And what has that been like ongoing when you've had that engagement?
So we're directly funded by the Scottish Government. So we work with the sponsor team on a regular basis, and we have at times access to ministers, cabinet secretaries, and to civil servants in different kind of positions. So I feel from V&A Dundee, we're in quite regular and, you know, vivid communication with the Scottish Government. I think I know where they're at, and I can see their challenges and their struggles. I hope they can see where we're at too, and actually what we require to be able to thrive, to kind of sustain in the way that they kind of expect of us. So for us personally at V&A Dundee, because we're directly funded, I think we have access that others don't. Saying that, though, I do think there's other conversations that are taking place around that expanded view that Annie has mentioned, that I do think it would be really good to bring in more sort of broader perspectives across the sector to that as well. But at the moment, I think the government are listening to certainly what organisations are saying. I think what we're all looking for is actually, you know, back to where we started this session on, what comes next.
Well, as somebody who's not funded by Scottish Government, we have to work hard, but we do make an effort to engage, and we reach out and we participate where there are opportunities. So I think I referred to earlier participating in a culture value summit and setting out what the role of the importance of local culture and local cultural participation across a wide range of areas. And if I could maybe move into that actually I think the engagement has to be beyond just the culture team. And I think the ask is, can we engage with the health team, the education team, the net zero team, the economy team more? Because that's actually the wider impacts, you know, so the priorities of poverty and reducing child poverty. We can talk in Glasgow about how culture can contribute to that. So we would welcome a wider conversation than just the culture team with across the DGs about how we can contribute through culture to achieving the wider Scottish Government priorities. But in a very short answer, from a non-funded perspective, we have to work hard, but we reach out, we send letters, we write, we make the effort, and so do try to meet people as much as we can.
Okay, just to say, my daughter and her partner actually had their first date in the Riverside Museum, so it is a national, obviously, four grandchildren later. It's clearly a national iconic building.
It's a different contribution to Scotland's population.
I think it's because it costs nothing, which brings us back to what we're discussing. Exactly. You know, it was... But basically, you said earlier on, and some of the things you're saying I'm quite excited about, you would be willing to work together for any kind of sector change. How do you see that working, and what would be needed in order to do that?
Is that to me?
Anyone.
No, to right. Okay.
Just anyone, go for it.
What would be needed for us to see, what would we need? I mean, I think it's the partnership with the funders and the stakeholders too. I guess there feels like there's a bit of a layer between us, and I don't mean specifically, I mean across the sector. So I think we all recognise the three big investors in culture in Scotland are the government, Creative Scotland, and local government. So I think even getting that working really well would be a really good start. I think a strong partnership across the three of those stakeholders would be great, and then I think we come in alongside that as a sector, and I think the volatility that we're experiencing is not really giving us the chance to do it. I think colleagues have articulated well that when you're experiencing that level of turbulence, you're kind of just trying to keep everything kind of steady and not flying away. But once we get that level of stability, and it feels like we're getting there with that, I think we then cohere around what do we want from state-supported culture, what does it uniquely do, and then what do we all achieve across all of Scotland, across all the different types of culture. And I think everybody's given a really, really good summary of the specific role that museums and galleries play in that. But I do think it starts with a really, really excellent partnership across those three major stakeholders.
I think I would just perhaps broaden that out a little bit, in that the culture sector isn't all funded by Creative Scotland. So I know that they play in a really important role, but there's also, that is Scottish Government money directed through Creative Scotland. There's also, of course, Historic Environment Scotland, the whole historic environment sector. And then there's museums and galleries as well. And we're each funded by Scottish Government to support different parts of the culture sector. MGS is in a different position in that we're an independent charity that is charged with supporting the sector. And we do receive money from Scottish Government to then pass on to the museums and galleries sector. So our grants budget this year is £1 million across 452 museums. So it's not kind of in any way a parity with what the resources available to Historic Environment Scotland
or the resources available to Creative Scotland. So we've got a slightly uneven map there, but I just think we need to also think about culture as a whole, and we need to think about the different elements of how that is, how that works, because the way museums and galleries work is not the same necessarily as how the arts sector works. So I suppose that's just recognising that it's quite a complicated pitch, but it absolutely has to be in partnership with local government as well, and I think we haven't cracked that yet in terms of how that partnership works, national government, local government, and the different agencies supporting and national development bodies supporting the culture sector to come together, because I think that willingness is there, but we haven't quite cracked that mechanism.
So just in summary, we're talking about possibly having a national conversation discussing about the importance of culture and how it affects every part of life and how we go forward to say we actually have confidence in the sector and what it gives back. Just summary of it, and we've got that bit right.
You made a really important point, because I think the value of culture in terms of cracking local government, back to what I said earlier, it has to be need to have rather than nice to have. Mm-hmm. And I think given the challenges in public sector, local authority funding, actually it's not necessarily seen as need to have, but we need to talk about it. And it is not a kind of a reductionist view. It is about we need to be clear about the wider impact that culture can have and can help, you know, within society, so that it is at its heart, as you said, valued in itself, and therefore seen as contributing. I think we need to do that in order for local authorities to understand why they should also invest in culture.
Mm-hmm. So just very quickly, I hope we could move quickly, though, if it's okay to suggest, from the importance and the value to how do you support it? Because I think all the outcomes that culture can generate really deep and long-lasting impacts require the sector in its broadest sense to be funded at a level to enable it to do that. So it's from a certain position, it can then work across social and healthcare, poverty, education, tourism, education, looking at unlocking innovation and like business models. It's from a base point that we're not quite at yet, but we're getting there, I think, that you can do have all those outcomes. I think in terms of the national conversation, there has been some national conversations around the development of the culture strategy, and albeit it could have gone further to address some of the areas that Lucy's setting out. But I think that national conversation needs to probably move from discussion of the value and the importance quickly to looking at the mechanisms to support it to enable to achieve those outcomes, if that makes sense.
I was just going to add, picking up on what Leonie was saying, that I think it is critical that we invite those other portfolios in and have those conversations, because we are delivering in those areas. They're not aware of it. There's budgetary implications with those. We could be making better use of the limited resource by having those conversations directly and understanding where we can aggregate and work together to have those outcomes and impact. So it is, yes, those three kind of key funding models, but I think it also has to open up and include those other areas too, because otherwise we are just duplicating or working at cross purposes, and that just is not any sort of good use of any resource.
No, in my case, you're preaching to the converted, because the Paisley 2021 City of Culture bid was all about that. Thank God we didn't win it, because we were in lockdown in 2021. But shame for Coventry. But but I get it. I understand it. That was the reason why that bid was made, was to say this can make a difference in the challenges the town face. So I get that. Nope, thank you, convener.
Thank you. Sorry, I'm losing my voice. Ms Gallagher, do you want to go in?
I think we're both in the same boat, convener, this morning. Good morning, panel. My question relates to local government, and we've spoken a lot about collaborative working, partnership between various levels of government, and of course that will be really important in relation to what happens over the next few years, particularly in line with the difficult financial challenges that we're all experiencing in terms of levels of finance available to different sectors. But something that's always struck me with local authorities is the different funding streams, or the ways in which local governments operate with their leisure and cultural assets. So some councils, of course, use arm's length external organisations. Other councils keep it more in-house, if I could use that as a phrase. So do you think this is difficult for the sector to navigate as a whole, because councils are doing different things in different places? And I'm wondering as well if a further review is needed in relation to arm's length external organisations and how councils operate their leisure and cultural assets to try and protect them as much as possible. Because another thing that local authorities have difficulty with just now particularly surrounds the use of ring fencing. And of course, that exposes our leisure and cultural assets as well, because those aren't within the protected brackets that other sectors are. I don't know who wants to kick off.
Susan.
I suppose maybe there's two parts. I would like to suggest that Glasgow Life has an ALIO, an arm's length, or a very large ALIO. We have a very positive working relationship with the Glasgow City Council. We work hand in hand, the council charges us with delivering on their policy areas in terms of culture. So we recently spent a lot of time consulting on a new culture strategy for the city. It was done with the sector, as I said, but it is ultimately adopted as a Glasgow City Council policy document. We have done the same with the vision for Glasgow Libraries, which we refreshed last year. And we are doing the same with a physical activity and sport, events and tourism. So that trusted relationship is there, and we work hand in glove with them. And I feel very strongly that relationship means we deliver on the city priorities, and that we can align how we support the citizens of the city to the council's strategic plan and still deliver. I think I referred to earlier the model that we are means that if we can income generate in one area, it helps to create the, maybe we're using the word ecology a lot today, but that ecology within the organisation, and also it supports cross working across the organisation. So our museums team are working with our libraries team around the city archives and making sure that the point about skills and experience, that we're using our conservation skills, our collections management skills, to look at how we then manage the city's archives. So that's just a wee bit a nugget in terms of my perspective of how things work, and I can only talk from that perspective. I think the ring fencing thing is really interesting, and obviously I did read the SIPFA Solace and COSLA submission, and I think that becomes increasingly difficult when there are protected areas within ring-fenced funding for local government. And I know the Verity House Agreement has committed to reduce that. But my experience in terms of looking at how the fee that we get from the council to deliver services is looked at is that on many occasions we have to deliver either a greater percentage and a greater value than the education services, and the greater value is maybe a more indicative one if you think about the kind of the spend that Glasgow City Council's education services have the budget associated with that. We are reducing our budget to greater value than they're being asked. So that, and that's back to that value judgment that talked about earlier, and you're faced with, you know, making a decision on one hand and actually if it's not ring fenced. And the word statutory, maybe in terms of libraries, I mean, Glasgow still does operate, for the record, 32 public libraries, which are well used, well resourced, and well loved. But if you're faced with that choice, then that is a difficult choice to make, especially in the context of ring fencing. I hope that helps answer the question.
No, thank you very much. I'm not sure if anyone else wants to come in at this point.
I suppose with our sort of national overview, and we convene a group of heads of service of both civic museums, local authority direct and ALIO heads of service to kind of share some of those issues. And I would say both models can be really successful. There are really successful examples both of ALIOs and of direct services. And there are some who are considering changes of model. But I think some of the things that are really at the heart of what is successful is where the potential role of culture can be understood. And I think, you know, Glasgow is an exemplar of that in terms of the role that culture can play in the city. I think Paisley is another one that's just had a mention in terms of really understanding the potential for that. So I'm not sure that the model is necessarily the heart of that. I think that both have their merits in that. And I think that's that understanding there. Actually, with the cross-portfolio thing we talk about nationally, there are really good examples of that working more locally, of where you've got cultural people embedded within health and within social care teams and things at local authority level. There are perhaps some things that we can learn nationally from some of the models that are happening within local authorities. I don't know if that's helpful.
Thank you. Anyone else at this point? No.
I don't think so, Megan. Sorry, did you have a supplementary? My apologies.
I do. Sorry, convener. It's just a short one because we've spoken, of course, and rightly so, about Glasgow, Edinburgh, Dundee, you know, in terms of their assets, in terms of their cultural significance and importance. But of course, we have local culture and heritage right up and down our country. And for an area like North Lanarkshire, where I represent, of course, that we're deep rooted in that industrial heritage that we're so well and well known for. So I'm wondering, how do we level up areas in terms of cultural protection? Because I can understand why we gravitate to areas such as Glasgow, Edinburgh and Dundee. But of course, we don't want to lose those deep-rooted cultural pockets and other areas that are very important in terms of our history, but also have excellent examples of localised museums and other cultural buildings as well. So how do we level up? And then if I could just add on another element to that as well, our rural communities, because of course, our rural communities are harder to get to. It's harder for people to visit museums in rural areas. How do we protect those areas as well? Because what we wouldn't want to see is areas that are more rural having that disappearing element of libraries, museums, and other really important cultural assets.
Lucy?
Thank you. I think it's a worthwhile mention of industrial collections in particular. I just want to start there because our industrial museums and galleries that tend to face really, really high costs because of the nature of the assets that they care for, often very large, often with substantial issues in terms of the scale of the sites that they're caring for in the collections. So there are particular issues there, and we have some particularly vulnerable industrial collections at the moment. So I think it's important to recognise those different costs that fall on different organisations, and again, there are different governance models across that in terms of how that's done. I think, so in a sense, that plays to the wider conversation we've been having about the need to support right across the spectrum of the museums and galleries that we have. In terms of some potential areas to look at, I think that one of the things industrial museums do really well is to collaborate. So the Industrial Museum Scotland, they've come together to share those issues and in some cases to share resources. In terms of rural museums as well, the museum forums that exist right across the country, or in most parts of Scotland, will have a museum forum where they can come together and share ideas and resources. And I think those hubs, in that sense, can be really, really powerful. There are also some examples, not lots of examples, of actually sharing a member of staff, for example, a Gaelic development officer shared across four different museums. And some of these models are things we probably need to look at if we want the health of the ecology of the sector as a whole, keep coming back to the ecology world, to be vibrant. So I think looking at those particular issues of different kinds of museums, but also different opportunities, because that's what they are, to collaborate and to share resources, to look at a more sustainable future. And I think that strategic piece is really, really important, that we do look at how we look at kind of different solutions to what we've had, because the model at the moment is, as we know, so difficult, so strained.
Thank you.
Leonie?
Yeah, I mean, I'm delighted that you're mentioning Dundee alongside Edinburgh and Glasgow, because I'm not sure it would always have been like that. So I think that's actually credit to, you know, many years of visioning a different Dundee that was connected to its sense of local place and heritage and culture. V&A Dundee only exists because of visionary founding partners and because there was other organisations there, DCA, Rhett, McManus, the Discovery Ship, the Unicorn, and of course a phenomenal university and art and design school. So I'm just so excited that you're seeing us as mainstream now, because it certainly doesn't always feel like it. And I know that I represent an organisation with a brand, you know, the V&A brand, and it obviously is world renowned and rightly so. But just in terms of our own organisation, we will only be successful if we are genuinely being national, international, regional, but deeply local. Our local audience is our greatest and most powerful stakeholder. And that's how we think about V&A Dundee. So we've done a lot of changes in the last few years to make sure that we're speaking locally, nationally, and internationally through the variety of programme and all the, you know, we had every school in the city into our museum last year, which was the first time we'd done that or achieved that level of rate of school attendance. So I think national institutions still have a deeply local responsibility, certainly ours, because we're in a city like Dundee does. And just maybe a slight off-piece point, we're also working with North Lanarkshire at the moment on an exhibition that was in Venice a few years ago, which looks at the post-industrial landscape of Ravenscraig alongside Loch Ness and the Orkney seashores as well. So, you know, I think we can connect out through what we do and those organisations too. It's not just, excuse me, what we bring to us, it's how we reach out as well and how I think national organisations show up across all of Scotland. And I think your point is right about that kind of geographic breadth and how we, and local is so important, that local culture is what keeps everything living, actually, and it does connect, it really does connect in. And I think we're all here for that, but within cities you can still get the same, I think, sense of barrier and removal. So in parts of our bigger cities or our bigger towns, there'll still be a sense that you're 100 miles away from a national institution when actually you're only a few miles away. I think I feel that we're working towards, you know, mitigating that very deeply within Dundee, and I'm sure other colleagues, and I, you know, had experience working in Paisley too, and we certainly felt the same and worked really hard to do it. So it's geographic across mileage, but the distance isn't always mileage, if that makes sense as well.
Yes. I'd like to pick up on that. That's a really good phrase. The distance isn't always mileage. We are, working in North Edinburgh and with our plans for the artworks, and this area is one of the most deprived in Scotland. Some of those residents wouldn't even make it into Edinburgh, to the Prince's Street, to any of our three city centre sites. But our plan is that with the collection storage facility, that they would have a very immediate access to it, and that it has the opportunity to impact their life in a positive way. And of course they are just as entitled and have access to the National Collection as anyone in Scotland is their collection too. We know it has a positive impact. We've surveyed our visitors, 85% of them said their well-being improved after engaging and connecting with art at our sites. So there is that hyper-local. But there's also, for us as a national institution, we do have that national remit. And as has already been mentioned this morning, we are dependent on that infrastructure throughout the country in order to partner up. We just closed an exhibition at our portrait gallery called Before and After Coal, and it was looking at the coal industry in three distinct areas in Scotland, Ayrshire, Fife and the Lothians. And I'm really happy to see that exhibition is now going on tour to Ayrshire and Fife. It'll be in Cumnock and Kirkcaldy. But it was touch and go as to whether this would be even possible, because our host partners weren't even sure if they would have the funds to be able to invigilate in the space. And our funds were so tight, we weren't even able to sort of look to provide any sort of assistance and grant there. We've been able, through creative working on all parties' counts, make this happen. And it's important that it does happen, because this exhibition, which opened here in Edinburgh earlier this year, it came about through a multi-year partnership with those communities. It was more than 5 years, where we were going out, our outreach officers, curators, various colleagues involved, we're consistently meeting and earning the trust and respect of those communities. And it wasn't so that we can just, as national galleries, kind of come in and parachute in and, you know, here it is. This is their story. We were privileged to hear this story, to bring it to Edinburgh, to show it alongside the permanent collection, and then to be able to take it back to those areas. So that is the relationships that we're talking about. It's the hyper-local, but it's also the national. It's with artist rooms. We have Vija Selmans was at Dunoonborough Hall. We have various partners all up and down from the Highlands and Islands to major cities around Scotland. But we're also limited there because we only have a certain amount of that collection up here in Scotland. We share it in joint ownership with Tate in London. And we don't have the storage facilities to be able to have the majority of the collection here, which means the people of Scotland are missing out on vital parts of our permanent collection just simply because we can't store it here. So there, again, it's always going to come back to this anchor funding that is needed right across the sector in order for us all to be able to thrive. And that is what we mean by the ecosystem, that we're all thriving.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Brown.
Thanks very much, and thanks for giving evidence today. I know we don't have a lot of time left, so what I was just going to do is just make a couple of comments, and members of the panel can comment maybe a little bit provocatively to see about response. It does seem a little bit like, having sat through this last year, this doom loop has continued without much in the way of perceived improvement. And I was struck by a comment that Anne made at the start about the sector wasn't confident. And I'm not sure how the sector can become confident if the population isn't confident. And I would say things like, you know, cost of living. I think the effects of the pandemic are much more profound and longer lasting than we perhaps give them credit for. We've seen riots in the country over the summer as well. So I'm not sure we've got a confident, settled population in a way that they would want to be more inclined to visit cultural institutions. But also, just as a member of the committee, what is useful to me is to know where, given the last comment was made from Anne about increased funding for the sector, where is the best place for this committee or individual members of it to put pressure? I'm just struck by the fact that we're now 14 years in austerity, which has reduced public services, reduced funding for public services across the board. We're now going to the 15th year and we're told that this budget is going to be much worse and there's a massive black hole. The Scottish Government said a 40% reduction in its capital budget this year. So it'd be interesting to know, is it the case the Scottish Government, in your view, is not apportioning the proper level of its budget towards culture? Or is there something else going on? Is it a view that the local government is doing the same? Are they not passing on proper proportions? It's simply the case, the scarcity of resources in local government is driving that. It'd be interesting to know where the pressure would be. And also, just to say, in relation to the local government situation, we've heard a lot from Glasgow, and we usually hear quite a bit from Edinburgh, usually around the festivals as well, but I represent an area which has no museum in the entire council boundary. It's got a small museum in the village in which I live, but it's not had one for two decades. And for them to go to Edinburgh or Glasgow, the cost of it is simply prohibitive. And we have higher levels of poverty than Glasgow per capita. So it's not really I would suggest, high in their list of priorities to see more funding go to Edinburgh or Glasgow if it's going to be at the expense of, well, there currently is no funding there. But and just to go to the point, I think Megan Gallagher raised a very good point about the richness of the history we have in our area. Perhaps the biggest cultural asset that we have in Clackmannanshire is the graveyard in Alloa, where Jameson from Jameson Whiskey, Usher, Younger, all these people are buried in some incredibly important cultural burials as well. But we don't have... we have Dollar Museum, which is a tiny little museum, but we don't have a council-wide museum. So how relevant is it to discuss, in a situation of scarce resources, more money going to Glasgow and Edinburgh? And I agree they should. I also agree with the point that's been made about people don't perhaps fully appreciate the knock-on and multiplier effect of spending on culture, and that's before you think about the beneficial, if you like, spiritual or mental benefits of it as well. But I would guarantee you go to every committee of this Parliament and you'll see people in front of the committee saying, if people just realised the impact, if they could spend a bit more on this, the impact it would have. The problem is, as I think you said, the money's not there in the first place. So I suppose those are just some of my thoughts. It'd be interesting to hear any comments from the panel.
I'll pick up on your question about the Scottish Government not apportioning a proper level of funding. I think the answer is a resounding yes. I mean, we've been all calling for a 1% funding of the culture portfolio. These are figures that are comparing us to the rest of Europe, where I think the average is 1.5. So, you know, and you look at some of the nations and it's well beyond that. So again, it's just on those terms and by those measures, then yes, there does need to be more funding. I do take your point that budget is stretched right across the portfolios. But I think again, it comes back to my point of how joined up though is it in terms of where those resources are being spent. So childhood poverty, during the summer months, we offer free lunches for families to come in. And this is a very targeted approach at looking at where children aren't receiving their school lunches when the school's out of session. So we call it Art Fuel, and they can come into our sites and they get a substantial lunch, but it's Art Fuel to help them engage and participate. So those are areas where we are stepping into other portfolios and providing. And it is coming out of the culture budget, but it's also having an impact elsewhere. So I think there needs to be a kind of real understanding of where those are all connected and how it is being used. And it's back to what Susan said, this isn't a nice to have, these are necessities. We need the culture in our life for us to survive, for us to sort of have a life that is meaningful, is rich and is creative. And to the point about the, you know, where, whether resource should come to the sort of the major cities. What I would hope I've sort of demonstrated today, or at least given some insight, is that while we may be physically sort of situated here in Edinburgh, we have our sort of buildings, our collection is not static. Our collection is out there around the country. My colleagues are out there around the country. We've done various programmes over the years in Alloa. We've been doing consistent work in North Ayrshire. We're doing all kinds of activities, but we have very limited resource. There are three outreach officers, and they're all, only one I think is full-time, and that's for serving the whole of Scotland. Back to funding, we have two development officers.
So just on that point, would it not be though more beneficial for something indigenous to Alloa or Ayrshire to happen, rather than having to rely on somebody else coming in? I appreciate if it's a question of a national collection, there'll be restricted access to that, but surely it'd be more sustainable and beneficial if, you know, across the country. I mean, I've hearing about your mining thing, I mean, the first mine in Scotland's up in Barora in the Highlands, no, wasn't it in Ayrshire or Lanarkshire or anywhere else? Just think that we're missing that trick about, and Richard DeMarco's done some fantastic stuff in Alloa as well, but if it's more indigenous and to that area, surely that would have a beneficial impact.
Well, absolutely. Again, it's not about, and this is, I guess, where perhaps I can elaborate more on my point about the mining exhibition. It's not about us sort of kind of being possessive around the culture. It's recognising that that culture and that heritage exists right across the country. But how can we support it within our national remit? So it's back to the funding that's required right across the sector. So it's, again, it's very much about where we can have those partnerships to be able to share. And it goes in both directions. It's not that, again, it's just sort of sending it out. It's about having those meaningful conversations and understanding what our culture, what our national culture is about. So there's ways of doing it. I mean, the difficulty is it becomes project-based rather than actual sort of foundational funding and support. So where we can send out an exhibition, we sent out the MacKinnon Collection of Photographs to Museum Nanaylin in Stornoway a few years ago. And with the funding that we had received from the National Lottery Heritage Fund, we were then able to say, right, well, you know what your local audiences need and want better than we do sitting here in Edinburgh. So let's work with you so that you can take these funds and that you can actually discharge them in a way that is going to have maximum impact and you know what you're doing. It's those kinds of partnerships because you, as Lucy's already testified with her evidence, there's already, you know, 11% of museums are threatened with closure this year. So it's not about then sort of, right, well, we'll create a museum in this small town or in this village, because we can't sustain them all. It's again about how are we strategic in using the resource that we have to maximise it to full effect.
Thanks.
And just say that I think hopefully I've not just talked about Glasgow, but also the role of local authorities and funding culture and Glasgow is many villages and many places and having a culture that reflects the people in the place is very important. And so I suppose in response to your observations, I would say that we have championed a programme of artists and community, so it is actually artists embedding themselves in you know, whether it's Calton in the east of Glasgow or Black Hill or Pollock, and actually working with the local heritage that is there or the local community that is there to respond to the issues that they want to discuss, but through culture. So, for example, one of our artists and communities worked in Molondiner and Black Hill. They worked on 3D sculptures, they worked on graphic design and performance, but what came out of it wasn't necessarily an object, but was materials and artworks for a campaign for clean air. And they used the sessions with the artists to create an advocacy programme with local politicians and campaigners. So in terms of the evidence I would like to give today is about the value of culture at a national level, absolutely, at an institutional level. But we really, really mustn't lose sight of the importance of cultural experience and communities and the role of culture in helping to discover identity, to explore heritage within our local communities, and whether that's through your library or through exploration of the local graveyard, which is a really big, I mean, I think the kind of the necropolis in Glasgow is top of TripAdvisor visits, you know, regularly. So that interest in understanding the people and the heritage. So my evidence is to recognise the role of local funding through local authorities for local culture.
Yep.
Conscious, we really need to finish by 20 past, so if you could be concise in your comments, I'm sorry.
Okay.
It's a Thursday morning, we've got no flexibility in this committee.
Understood, so three quick points. First of all, absolutely endorse 1% of culture budget, of Scottish Government budget to culture, is something that we share as an ambition, and I say is in those comparisons across Europe, is we feel a reasonable ambition to have. Secondly, I think in any review that we have of how this sector is funded, we need to look at that from the point of view of communities. We need to take that place-based approach to access to culture. Declaration of Human Rights has there is a human right to access culture, so we do need to look at where that provision is before kind of looking at who is providing that, because I think that can be provided from a national site, it can be provided at a regional, it can be provided locally. And my third point is to never underestimate the amount, power of small sums of money in the hands of local people. And we shouldn't be looking at this as an either or. I mean, that we ran a programme during the year of stories where we put grants of up to £3,000 in the hands of local people, and there were the richness that came from that. We need to be investing at that local level as we need to invest at the national level, because together we can do something really powerful. But I think taking that look of access to culture and how and who has that is fundamental, because actually the structures that we have and how we provide that is something that we need to sort. But if you're a member of a community, you don't care if that museum is run by the council or by an independent charity or run by nationally. You want to have access to really good, high quality, inspiring culture in your area. Thank you.
Is everybody finished contributions? Then thank you to the committee for the questions. To Ms Cassett, Ms Deegan, Ms Bell and Ms Lydon, thank you very much for your attendance this morning. And I now close the meeting.